Let it be known to all of you. And that's the way a preacher talks. This is the most important issue for everyone today. You have nothing greater going on in your life today than salvation. There is not one drop of salvation outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. This salvation is the chief priority of your life. More important than where you stand with men is where you stand with God. More important than where you live in this world is where you will live in the world to come. More important than your body being made well is your soul being made well. More important than the well-being of your physical, financial, and social state is the well-being of your spiritual state. How can sinful man and sinful woman be right before a holy God? Or to put it another way, how can a guilty sinner find acceptance with an infinitely holy God in heaven? On one side of the debate was the Roman Catholic Church, which held that salvation is in Jesus Christ and good works and church membership and baptism and indulgences and treasury of merit and the Mass and confession and purgatory and Mary and prayers to the saints and last rites and ad nauseum. And no one in the Roman Catholic Church could ever know if they ever had salvation, for who in the world could ever live up to such a list of religious superstition as this? But the Reformers, Martin Luther, John Calvin, William Tyndale, John Knox, they spoke with one voice, and that voice was the voice of the Bible. And they countered with a resounding no. Salvation is in Christ alone. Christ, period, paragraph. The entire Reformation was all about the recovery of the one true saving gospel of Jesus Christ. Rome said salvation is by Christ, and the Reformers said salvation is in Christ alone. Christ alone is related to every other sola. Scripture alone is the word of Christ alone. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. You can't have faith alone in anything else but in Christ alone. And Christ is given by God by grace alone to unworthy, undeserving, hell-bound sinners. And even the faith to believe in Christ alone is from the grace of God alone. No one can believe on their own. God must grant saving faith before a spiritually dead man can believe upon Christ. What can a dead man do? Stink. That's all a dead man can do. And spiritually dead sinners cannot exercise faith in Christ alone. There is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. This is the greatest declaration ever made to man. There is salvation. We're not talking about social justice here or anything like that. There is a negative and a positive component of this word salvation. Negatively, the word salvation means delivered, rescued, so as to escape impending danger and ruin and perishing. And every person on planet Earth must be delivered from impending doom. And then positively, salvation means to be saved unto a right relationship with God. It is the restoration of man's broken relationship with God. From what do we need to be saved? You and I must be saved from God Himself, from the wrath of Almighty, Holy God against sinners. You and I don't need to be saved from loneliness. We don't need to be saved from poor self-esteem or insecurity or a meaningless life or a poor job or whatever. Those are nothing compared to your real need, which is to be saved from God Himself. And there is only one who can save from God, and that is God Himself. Only God can save you from God. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all who do iniquity. Not just hate iniquity, but hate all who do iniquity. Hate the persons of iniquity. God is angry with the wicked every day. You destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord abhors the man of bloodshed and deceit. Those are strong words. And the God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament. We read God is a righteous judge and a God who has indignation every day. If a man does not repent, he, referring to God, he will sharpen his sword. He has bent his bow and made it ready. He has also prepared for himself deadly weapons. He makes his arrows fiery shafts. This is God. They're already on his bow of judgment. And the arrow is set and the bow is pulled back. And as Spurgeon says, God never misses his mark. There's far more to the story than God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. The Lord tests the righteous and the wicked, meaning he sees both the saved and the unsaved, and the one who loves violence. Note the person. The one who loves violence, his soul hates. Verse 6, upon the wicked, he, God, will rain snares, fire, and brimstone, and burning wind will be the portion of their cup. This is why everyone needs to be saved. They need to be saved from the impending judgment of God and fiery hell and the bowels of the lake of fire and brimstone. Where is this salvation found? We cannot be wrong here and be right anywhere else. This is the question of the ages. Please note it does not say nothing else. It says no one else. No one is a personal pronoun. This has nothing to do with a thing. It has everything to do with a person. There is salvation in no other person. Salvation is not in church. Salvation is not in an institution. Salvation is not in a cause. It's not in a baptistry. It's not in church membership. It's not in the offering plate. It's not in the code of one's conduct. Salvation is found in only one place, and that place is a person, and that person is none other than Jesus Christ the Lord. There is salvation in no other name except Christ and Him crucified, Christ and Him raised from the dead. Salvation is not in any other name. It's not in Moses. It's not in Paul. It is not in Allah. It is not in Mohammed. It is not in Buddha. It is not in Confucius. It is not in the Pope. It is in Jesus Christ alone. No one else has been born of a virgin. No one else has kept the law perfectly. No one else has gone to a cross and could die in my place. No one else has propitiated the righteous anger of God towards me and towards my sins. No one else could reconcile me and be equal with God, yet be equal with me. No one else could pay the debt of the wages of sin for me. No one else has been raised from the dead. No one else is seated at the right hand of God the Father, except Jesus Christ. We're not just dogmatic about this, we're bulldogmatic about this. The scripture speaks with such clarity. There is not one drop of saving grace outside of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, and there is no receiving of saving grace outside of faith alone in Christ alone. No one can have this salvation who tries to put one foot in Christ and one foot in the church. And a partial commitment to Christ, but also trusting in anything else, church membership, baptism, their own good works, whatever. It is not until a person comes all the way to Christ alone and puts both feet in Jesus Christ and puts all of their trust in Him is their salvation granted. We cannot save ourselves. We must be saved. Someone else must save us. We are hopeless and helpless, and the only contribution we make to our salvation is the sin that was laid upon the Lord Jesus Christ. It is all of grace, and it is all by faith in Christ alone. He is the only Son God sent to save sinners. He is the only Savior of the world. He is the only door leading into eternal life. He is the only Good Shepherd of the sheep. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. There is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. A mediator stands between two parties that are at odds with each other, two parties where there is hostility, and the mediator steps in to bring about reconciliation. The mediator must be impartial to both sides. He must be equal to both sides to bring about true and proper mediation. That is why Jesus Christ had to be the God-man, 100% God and 100% man. He was God in human flesh. He was also able to represent man because Jesus Christ was fully man. And it is through the mediation of the Lord Jesus Christ at the cross that Jesus has brought together the two offended parties, holy God and sinful man. And God is at enmity with man in his sin. And man is at enmity with God, unconverted man. But God in His grace and God in His mercy has sent His Son to be the mediator between God the Father and the human race. God was under no obligation to do this, but out of the depths of His eternal love, He sent His Son. Him who knew no sin, God made to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. It's the great exchange of the cross. All of my sin laid upon Him. His perfect righteousness laid upon me. The worst about me laid upon Him. The best about Him laid upon me. And He became a curse for us upon that tree. And it is through the shedding of His blood that there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And by the death of Christ, He has redeemed us. That means He went into the marketplace of this world where we were held captive by our sins and held captive by a personal devil. And through His death upon the cross, He bought us and then brought us out of the slave market of sin. And if the Son shall set you free, you shall be free indeed. And through His death, He crushed the head of the serpent. And we once were children of darkness and children of the devil, and we now are sons and daughters of light, and we are children of God. And it has all been effected by Christ alone. If you want to be laughed at, scorned, hated, even persecuted, testify to the exclusive claims of Jesus Christ. Say that Jesus is the only Savior, that only by believing in Him can one escape death. The world will fight you to the death because nothing is so offensive to the natural man. We cannot save ourselves, that we cannot choose our own way of salvation, and that if we are going to be saved, it must be by God in the way He has appointed. There are not many roads leading up the mountain to come to God. There is only one way, and it is Jesus Christ. You may say, that sounds so narrow-minded. Yes, it does. You may say, this sounds so exclusive. Yes, it is exclusive. You may say, it sounds so intolerant. Yes, it is intolerant of any other way. God is intolerant of any other religion or man's attempts to save himself. I want to ask you this question, and I want to be very personal. Have you been saved? Do you have salvation?